is that our goal here is to capture the surprisingly and intriguing behavior and try to visualize this intriguing behavior of modern database systems. So what you'll also find is that because the projector seems to be having some difficulty, the first letter or the first column in each of the slides will be cut off. But I was told that you guys are smart, so you should be able to fill in the information, right? Okay. So I think almost all of you would already have done a database course. How many of you have not done it so that you can catch all of us? Okay, shame on you. Okay, sorry. But anyway, so as you would already know, is that basically database systems are these extremely large and incredibly complex software systems which run to millions of lines of code. And they're basically meant for handling data through its entire life cycle, starting with capturing the data, storage, querying, and maintenance. Okay? But if that doesn't impress you, well, what you'll find is that it's essentially the cornerstone of the computer industry. More than 80% of the computers worldwide are used for data processing in one form or the other. And then if you go on the assumption, which is reasonable, that one computer is equal to one person, then more than 70% of the computer professionals are engaged in some activity related to data processing. So what it also means, which might be a sobering thought for most of you here, is that two-thirds of you here would wind up in database systems, whether you like it or not. Okay? So you might as well start liking it right now. And then, of course, we fund the rest of the computer science industry. Okay? So you don't get money by doing architecture. You don't get money by doing operating systems. I hesitate to say anything about cryptography and so on. But essentially, you would see that if you look at all the companies now, look at a company like Sun Microsystems, okay? Excellent company which produced really good quality hardware, especially with RISC architectures for the last three decades. That was bought by Oracle, okay? Because only database companies have money. All the architecture companies are going bankrupt. And so Oracle recently bought Sun, and then they have now produced a new chip called the M7. Which has database operations built into the directly into the hardware. Okay? So it's a general purpose processor, but it also has specific micro architecture related to database systems in the basic processor itself. Okay, so just to jog your memory, here are some of the well-known offerings from the commercial world with regard to database systems. So there you have a DB2 from IBM, then there's SQL Server from Microsoft, SQL MX from HP, and then this is something you might be more familiar with because it's very popular in India, Exadata from Oracle, and then there is an SAP HANA, and there used to be a separate company called Sybase IQ, which has now been bought by SAP. Okay. So these are the offerings in the commercial domain. And then in the public open source world, you also have PostgreSQL, which hopefully many of you would have seen in some form or the other, and then there's also MySQL and BerkeleyDB. So the reason that database systems are so popular is that they come armed with a large number of goodies. Okay? There's lots of excellent features that it has. I'll just highlight two of them to you here in this particular talk. The first one is that the only reason that you can sleep peacefully at night, okay, for those of you who do sleep at night, okay, hopefully you're doing assignments, working hard, reading the lecture notes and so on, of which Bhavana was mentioning, discrete math and stuff like that. But for those of you who do happen to sleep, the only reason you can sleep peacefully at night is because of database systems. They give you peace of mind. Why is that? Because any changes that you make to the database system are guaranteed to be immune to any subsequent system failures. So whether you have a volcano, whether you have an earthquake, whether you have a bombing, or whether you just have the Sultan movie opening in the nearby theater, it doesn't matter. Once you send money to me, okay, please do so. Okay, once you send money to me, it will be recorded in the database no matter what subsequent events occur. Okay? This is, you might have remembered what this property is called in the database textbooks. This is called the asset property. Right? And asset property is basic to database systems. So there's a convoluted chemistry which is going on there. So that's the one of the USPs of database systems. So in a sense, you can call it as the Sri Sri Ravi Shankar of the information world. Minus the long hair, of course. Okay. The other reason that database systems are extremely popular, and this is what we'll concentrate on for the rest of the talk, is that they provide you what is called as declarative access. That is, you only have to state the target goal without specifying the means to achieve this goal. Okay. this is very different from your traditional programming, where if you have a target, let's say, to multiply two matrices, you declare the variables, and then you say this is the first step that you need to do. You have to take the row here and the column there and so on. And then you have to add up all these values and the partial sums and stuff like this. So every step of the way you have to specify, and then the program is executed on the machine. But database systems are a lot more powerful. They just say that you specify me the goal, and then I'll figure out the way to achieve that. Okay? So this is very similar to the way that professors normally talk to PhD students. Okay? So they come and say that, okay, what should I do? So go write a great thesis. Okay? After a few weeks, the student comes back having gathered up the courage to meet you again, saying that, but how should I do it? You say, don't ask me, you go figure it out, right? Of course, that's not done in IISc. This is a special place. Here, the PhD student says this to the professor, saying, go write the thesis, and then we usually do it in a few years and then give it back to it. But this is a declarative access. Okay? You'll also find this in the industry. Managers want something right now, right? That is what normal mode of interaction that you have in the corporate world. So this is a very important aspect of database systems, is that you are permitted this declarative access. And in particular, virtually all the database systems that you find in the world today are a specific class of database systems, and this is called as the relational database systems. And in case you have not seen this before, the reason that they are called relational systems is that they are all based on this mathematical foundation of first order logic, augmented with existential and universal quantifiers. Okay? And this was discovered or developed or invented by Ted Kord of IBM's Almaden Research Center. So IBM has had most of the major database breakthroughs have come from the IBM Research Centers, which were located in the US. There's a TJ Watson Research Center on the East Coast, and there is the Almaden Research Center on the West Coast. So virtually all the major initial ideas in database systems came from the groups here, because they had excellent researchers working in these areas. And in fact, Ted Kord also got the Turing Award in 1981. Okay? So if you're thinking that one reason you don't want to work in database systems is, maybe I won't get the Turing Award if I work here, perish that thought. There are at least four people, including last year's Turing Award winner, which is Michael Stonebreaker from UC Berkeley and MIT, who got the Turing Award. So if that was holding you back, don't bother. You can still get the award here. And because it was designed by Ted Kord, it has led to this well-known aphorism in the database community, is that we believe in Kord and not God. Okay? So what is the basic idea in the relational model? It's very simple. It's the data is stored in a set of relations. And for the purpose of this talk, we'll just think of the mathematical concept of relation as equivalent to the physical concept of a table. The table has rows and columns. Okay? That's all that it has. And these are tables are annotated with attributes which correspond to the columns. And then there are relationships across the tables. And then there are various kinds of constraints that decide what kinds of values can be put within these rows and columns. Okay? So for a usual university database, you will find tables like this. So there are three tables here. This is student, course, and register. Student table has information about the roll number of the student, the name, and the address. Course similarly has information about what is the course identifier, what is the title of the course, and how many credits you get for it. And then register tells you, it hooks up the information between these two tables by saying which students are registered for which course and what is the grade that they have gotten when they took this particular offering. Okay. So now, how do you go and access information which is stored in this kind of relational setup? For that, we have the structured query language, also known as SQL or SQL, which was again invented, as I said, like most other good ideas in database systems, by the IBM Almaden Research Center in the 70s. So for example, if you wanted to list the names of the students and the courses that they're taking, what you would do is to simply write an expression like this. And what this means in simple English is that it's saying that take the information from the student, the course, and the register tables, and then pull out the student names and the titles of the courses. And how do you pull out this information from these three tables? You need to establish some kind of semantic meaningful equality there. So the predicate is that the roll number of the student here should match with the roll number here, which is a register table. And similarly, the course number in the register table here should match the course number here. So that is how you are doing establishing linkages. So the linkages in the relational world are established through value, whereas prior to the relational model, there was things called the network model, there was a hierarchical model, and so on. Hopefully, some of your teachers might have told you about this. All those were based on explicit pointer references, whereas the relational model was unique because everything was based on value. And one of the other advantages of the relational model is that any operation on a relation produces a new relation. Okay? This was not true in the other models. So this is very similar to the Unix philosophy, because remember Unix, everything was a file. Okay? Initially it was except processes. Processes were not files, but today even processes are addressable as files. Okay? So the same kind of a unifying concept that you found in the Unix operating system is also there in the database one. Okay. So now you see that you're basically been able to ask this question of listing the names of students and their courses. But in the process, what you'll see is that you have only specified the target, but not specified how this whole process should actually be implemented. Okay? So what are the kinds of things that have not been specified? The first step is that when you combine this information across the two tables, it's called as the join operator, okay, which is also symbolized with this bow tie symbol that you see here. So you have not specified the join order. That is, in which sequence should these tables be joined? So for example, you could join the student table with the register table first and then join it with the course table. Okay? That's one option that you have. Or maybe for vastu reasons, you might say, no, I want to join the register table with the course table first here and then join it with the student table. Would you get different answers in the two cases? No, you'll get the same answer. Why? Because the join is a associative and commutative operator. Okay? So the sequence does not matter. It's quite possible that the amount of time taken to produce the two answers would be enormously different. This may come out in a few seconds, and this you may have to wait for your grandchildren to show up and collect the answer. The final answer will be identical, but the time taken to reach the answer could be very different in the two cases. So let's say even if you did specify the join order and said that, okay, I like this for some particular reason, what has not been specified is how do you implement this operator? Because for each of these operators, a large number of alternative algorithms are available, especially in the 1970s and 80s. It had become a cottage industry. Everybody and their grandmother were producing new join algorithms, saying this is a better way of doing it. Okay? So you would have, for example, seen the nested loops algorithm in your course, okay, which is essentially two pointers going through the tables. Then you have more sophisticated algorithms which are based on initially sorting the tables and then doing a merge. Or you could have a hash join, there's index join, there is semi-join. Okay, lots of different variations are available. Which one would you use given this particular sequence? So now the nice thing about database systems is that job is not something that you have to worry about. Instead, it is done by a module which is deep inside the database engine. So if you go inside a SQL server from Microsoft, or if you go inside the DB2 of IBM, you'll find a component called the query optimizer, which will identify the ideal way of executing this query. And this is usually called as the query execution plan. So typically we just use the word plan. So whenever I use the word plan in the remainder of this talk, that essentially refers to this ideal strategy, which is to say that, oh, use this particular sequence and then use a hash join for this particular join and use nested loops here. That would be, for example, a possible strategy. So to make that more concrete, if you have never seen a database execution plan before, well, the strange animal looks like this. It is essentially a tree of operators which are evaluated in a bottom-up fashion. At the leaves of the tree, you'll have the tables that had been given by the user. So you have the student table, you have the course table, and you have the register table. And in this particular case, what this tree is telling you is that first combine the course and the register table using a merge join. Okay? Even if you don't know what a merge join is, it doesn't matter. It's just one way of implementing this combination of information between two tables. And then it says that you still have one more join left, which is to combine it with the student table. For variety purposes, let's use a hash join instead here. Okay? So you do a hash join here, and then out comes the answer. So this is one possible implementation to start from the initial data and to come out with the answers at the other end. So you'll also notice that each of the operators that you see here have been annotated with a value, and that value is what is called as the cost value, and basically tells you what is the expected amount of time that it takes to execute the subtree under that particular operator. So for example, what this is saying is that what table scan is that it looks at the database or the database table from one end to the other. So essentially you get the disk head going to the beginning of the file, and then it goes smoothly from one end to the other. Okay. So here the register table, it says that it takes me 200,000 units of time roughly to do a complete scan of this table. And then if I have to additionally sort it, then it requires an additional 25,000 units of time. So when you see the numbers here, this is the aggregate cost. Okay, so it keeps increasing as you go up. So essentially the cost at any level is the total cost of the subtree under it. So as you go up the ladder, you find that the largest cost will be at the very top node, which tells you how much effort does it take to execute this entire query. You said you wanted the student names and the course titles. Well, it will cost you something of the order of 300,000 units of time. That's what this is. Yeah. So this is the total execution cost which is here. So now the issue is that how do you choose a good plan? What is a good plan? The good plan is the one which will take the least amount of time to complete, right? Because we know that there are many alternatives, but there is a huge difference in the alternatives with regard to the running times, and I would like to choose the most efficient way of executing this query and taking it to completion. So in each of the database systems, they have their own, in some sense, hidden sauce as to how to do this query optimization well. But at the core, that's at the heart, they all have the same technique, which is essentially that there is a dynamic programming technique, which builds up the ideal results starting from at the atomic level, the optimal solutions, and basically building up the solutions up through the tree that we just saw, which is the tree of operators that you have. So you follow this dynamic programming strategy to essentially build up the final optimal strategy. So again, if you have not done this, it doesn't matter. The big picture is just that you have a nice algorithmic way of finding the best possible strategy. So you, given this SQL query, you invoke the query optimizer and say, please give me an efficient solution, and it will come out with the plan, which is the minimum cost, which essentially means that this is the fastest plan. Okay? So there are various inputs that come to the query optimizer. One is, what is the search space of possible trees? So I showed you a tree of operators in the previous slide. So first of all, what kinds of trees do you allow? Is it only Nilgiri trees, or is it only eucalyptus trees, or is it only Gulmohar trees? In the database world, that corresponds to things like what are called as left deep trees, where there is a user table connecting up on the right side edge of each of these joins that you have here. So the A, B, C, D corresponds to the user tables. Or you could have a bushy join here, where A and B are first combined, C and D are combined, and then these two intermediate relations are then combined again. Okay? So lots of different variations are possible, but you have to decide the search space. Then, given that you have the search space, how do you do the costing of the search space? Because you said, okay, here is one tree, here's another tree, what is the cost of the tree? Okay? So for that, you will have to be able to take each of these operators and basically be able to figure out what is the amount of running time that you estimate for this operation to complete. So, for example, if you take the nested loops join, which would be the basic join operator that you'd have seen in your courses, then if you join two tables, R and S, typically what the overall cost would be is that it's proportional to the sizes of the two tables. The sizes could be either in terms of rows or in terms of blocks, but essentially it tells you that if you ignore this additive component, it's proportional to the product of the sizes of the two tables. So then you'll say, but how do I know the sizes of these two tables? That's where the third component comes in, which is the last one here, which you see as the database catalogs. So the great thing about databases is that not only do they have data, but they also have metadata. That is, it describes itself. Part of the metadata is to also keep statistics about all these different tables with regard to things like how many blocks do they have, what is the number of different unique values that you have in a particular column, and so on. But the key point to note, even if you don't know the mechanics of this, is that this is a horribly expensive procedure. Why is it so expensive? Because you have to essentially search and do an exhaustive search of an exponential space. Where does the exponent come in from? Just assume you had n different tables and you just wanted to see which is the best sequence to join them. Okay? You saw in the previous slide we said R join S and then C, or you could have had S join R and then with C, and so on. If you had n different tables, immediately you have n factorial permutations. Note that we have just looked at the sequencing. We have not even looked at which algorithm is going to implement the join operator and so on. So it's actually a doubly exponential problem. But even at the simplest level of abstraction, you find that you have an exponential search space here. So this becomes extremely expensive. Okay? And that is why you have to use a dynamic programming kind of strategy to bring some sanity into this mess. So now you might say that why do you want to go and check out all these different trees and strategies? why don't you just go to Tirupati instead, break a few coconuts, eat a few laddus, and then come and say, this is the right plan. Okay? That, then you might say that the problem here is that the cost difference between the best choice and a random choice is enormous. And when they say enormous, here we're not dealing with small differences saying, oh, you took 10 seconds, I took 12 seconds. Here we are talking about differences like you took 10 seconds, I took 55 years. Okay? Or I have to wait till the world ends because that was supposed to end in 2012, but now they postponed the ending of the world. Right? Hopefully it will happen by this December. Right? You have to wait till the end of the world. Okay? Or if you remember the Douglas Adams book, Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, you have to wait till the computer comes back and tells you 42, right? So the differences are in orders of magnitude. These are not small change differences, enormous thing. Okay? And then, as I said, you cannot do this random choice because, as happens with most of the other things in the world, only a very small percentage of the plans in the search space are really good. Most of the others are horrible. Very similar to the GATE exam or like how you guys got selected. There are millions of students in the country, right, who all applied for this particular undergraduate summer school. But you guys were carefully picked because either you knew the organizers or you had a good background and you had done well in your undergraduate studies, right? So just the same way that we are doing the selection process from a large population and finding only a few good people and the rest of it is terrible, the same thing happens in database systems. So doing a random choice does not work. Even if you take 10 random choices, it doesn't help. Because this is the proverbial tail of the elephant. Most of it is terrible. It will take several years to complete. There's only a few plans which will actually do very well. So you have to actually exhaustively go through the entire space to find out the right solution. Okay. So now let's look at how does this query optimizer work. Okay. So the choice of the plan will be a function of different variables. One is, of course, what is the question that you're asking. Okay. In the previous slide, we had asked the question saying, please pull out the names of the students and the titles of the courses. It's also a function of the size of the database and the distribution of values. And of course, it's also a function of the system. Is it a laptop or is it a supercomputer like the one which we have in the neighboring building? If those of you who have not had time to go outside this building, before you leave the institute, please make sure to go to the Department of Computational and Data Science, which is next door. This is a large pink elephant that you see there, which is also called the Supercomputer Education Research Center. On the ground floor, you will see the Cray XC40, okay, which is one of the world's fastest supercomputers. It was installed about a year and a half ago. Can you guess? Okay, since we are in questions, can you guess what is the cost of that machine? Okay. Because your parents' income tax money paid for it, so you should, probably should want to know, okay, assuming they were paying income tax and not using it to fund your studies. Okay. Can you guess what is the price of that machine? Okay. It's a one petaflop machine. Sustained performance is like 900 teraflops, one petaflop machine. Yeah, yeah, you had an estimate? It's actually quite right. Okay, so now you guys are used to it. So it's actually 85 crores. A single machine is 85 crores. So once you have that system, then everything will go lightning fast. In fact, a recent experiment we did, which used to take 4 years earlier, was completed in 4 hours. Okay? So serious horsepower and heavy lifting ability in that machine. But typically what you'll have is that you have a given system and you have a database. That's fixed. Okay, you have bought the machine, you have populated it with the database, and now you are trying to say that I'm going to ask different questions and come up with efficient ways of answering these questions. Okay? So the execution plan, if you keep these two fixed, is essentially a function of what are called as the selectivities of the relations that have been given by the user, like the student relation, the course relation, the register relation, so on. And I'll tell you what selectivities mean in the rest of this talk. So essentially, it is the estimated fraction or percentage of rows given a table that are relevant towards producing the final result. So you have a Maha table here. Some part of it is relevant towards producing the final answer. That fraction is what is called as the selectivity. So to make this concrete, here is a somewhat more complicated SQL query than what you might already have seen in your undergraduate textbooks. In fact, this is a fairly tough query because you notice that even the from clause itself, where you are used to having nice user tables saying student, instructor, faculty, and so on, this itself is an embedded SQL query here. Okay. So if you're not able to parse this in real time, let me put you out of your misery. What this SQL query is doing in simple English is that it's determining the values of goods shipped between a pair of nations. Here the pair of nations is France and Germany. During a certain time period, here the time period is between the beginning of 1995 and the end of 1996. Okay? So you know that the French and the Germans hate each other, but they still do have some amount of trade between each other. So you want to be able to figure out in this 2-year period how much trade occurred between these two neighboring countries. And that is done with this entire SQL query. And you'll notice that this is coming from a database which is called as a manufacturing database, which corresponds to a benchmark called TPCH. So this is trying to mimic the real world in a benchmark where it tries to show you what happens in a typical corporate database. And then companies compare their performance on this benchmark database. So this TPC stands for the Transaction Processing Council, which is an independent watchdog of the database industry. And it has specified the database and this query as being something which is likely to occur in the real world. Okay, so now in this particular, and this a benchmark has 22 queries, and this is query number 7 of the benchmark in this suite of 22 queries. So now on top of this, so the tables that you see here, because it's a manufacturing database, are things like suppliers, because people are supplying parts. Then you have customers. Customers are playing orders. Each of the orders, there are different segments of it and different items that are being sold. So these are line items. And then the nation tells you from which country this is being sold, where the customer is located, where the company is coming from, and so on. Okay? So a fairly standard kind of a corporate or manufacturing database. Now on top of this, you could, let's say you had these two predicates. Okay? The first predicate is saying that the total price of the order, so this O comes from the orders table, should be less than or equal to some magical constant C1. Okay? So that's the predicate in red here. So for example, if you say that C1 is very low, it's only, let's say, 10 rupees or so, very few of the orders would qualify, okay? Because most of the orders are much larger. Whereas if you said that C1 is a very large number, okay? What is the largest number that we know? What is the largest number that you know? What is the largest number that you know? Not infinity. That's the boring mathematical answer. I call it the A Raja number, okay? 1,85,000 crores, right? Remember, 2G scam, okay, people looking stunned, not part of GATE syllabus. But 2G scam, 1,85,000 crores. It's very hard to put your head around that number, okay? So if you put that, all the orders will qualify, okay? So this I call the A Raja limit. So you can go from 10 rupees or to the other thing. The other predicate that you see here is about the account balance of the customer. So C stands for customer, this is account balance. And you're looking at what is, and here is another constant C2. If you set C2 to be low, okay, what do you automatically know? You know that this is the account balance of a faculty from IISc, right? So then you'll find that very few of the customers would qualify. Okay? Leave the 400 faculty here, everybody else is doing much better in the real world. Whereas if you, what is the largest value you can think of C2? What would be the largest balance that you have? Okay, ask Vijay Malya, right? There's a few things. So or you guys, after your, some of you are threatening to join the industry immediately after this, and I'm sure we'll see your pictures on the Deccan Herald newspaper saying that this guy got 2 crores from Facebook or whatever, right? So put a number like that, all the customers would qualify here. So essentially what these two numbers, C1 and C2, give you is that they give you two knobs. And using those knobs, you can vary what is the fraction of orders and what is the fraction of customers on the tables that are relevant towards the final answer. So essentially what you get is, yeah, so this value of C1 determines the selectivity of the orders relation, and this value C2 tells you what is the selectivity of the customer relation. So using those two, now you can come up with this two-dimensional space that I've shown here. So this is selectivity of orders going from 0 to 100%. And this is selectivity of customer going from 0 to 100% again. And essentially, the selectivity is determined by the values of C1 and C2. Low values of C1, you're saying very few orders qualify. Low values of C2, very few customers qualify. But as you keep increasing the values of C1 and C2, then the selectivity keeps increasing. So if you had a very large value of C1, virtually 100% of the rows in the table are useful because everybody falls within that bracket. If you had a very large value for C2, all the customers qualify and they will have to be processed in terms of getting out the final result. So this is what we call as the relational selectivity space. And on top of this space, you can draw a variety of diagrams. So the first diagram is what we call as the plan diagram, and this is essentially a visualization of what are the choices being made by this beautiful query optimizer, which is trying to find the most efficient way of exercising or of implementing your query over this relational selectivity space. So you have this two-dimensional space, and at each point corresponds to a different SQL query. And what you're trying to find out is that, can I visualize what is the strategy going to be used by the database query optimizer at each of the locations in this space? And I'll show you an example of this in the next slide, okay? But this is the background. And apart from the plan diagram, you can also come up with a complementary diagram, which is called the cost diagram, which is telling you the visualization of what are the estimated costs of these optimal choices over the same space. So this is telling you who is the best. This is telling you how expensive is the best solution. Okay. So it's like saying that who is the gate topper, person X, what was their score, that is the Y. That's the second part here. Okay. So to make this concrete, here is a sample diagram. Again, notice that the X-axis is the same orders table I told you before. So this is saying the total price of the order goes from 0 to 100% with regard to how much of the table you're going to lift into the main memory and start processing. Similarly, here is the customer table going from 0 to 100%. Now, each of the colored regions within the space refers to a specific plan. So, for example, it's saying that the red plan that you see here is the best possible choice if your query happens to be located anywhere in this region. Because notice that any combination of these values, so let's say 40% here and 30% here, corresponds to a specific instance of C1 and C2, which corresponds to a specific SQL query. Okay? So, for this SQL query, it's saying use the red plan. We'll see what red corresponds to in the next slide, but some red plan is going to be used. And it says that if you have 60 and 20 also, use the red plan. This guy is really good. Use it all over this space. Okay? So think of it like the Rahul Dravid plan. Okay? Use it in most of the teams. Good guy to always have in your team. Okay? You'll also see that there are six different colors like this. Each of them refers to an optimal plan. Going from P1, which is the red plan, which occupies roughly about half the space here. So what you see on this legend you see here is the plans, these ideal plans, which are organized according to the area that they cover in descending order on this two-dimensional space. So P1 occupies roughly 50% of the space. And then you come down all the way to the brown plan, which is P6, which occupies only 0.2% of the space. If you didn't see it earlier, this is that plan here. Hiding in this corner is the brown plan, which is the ideal solution that is recommended by the optimizer for queries which are located here. Okay? So now you have six different strategies, and we are saying that each of the strategies is ideal in some part of the space. Okay? Now, if you said, what is inside the red plan? What is inside the blue plan? Here is the example of the red plan. This is the tree structure of the red plan. Okay? What is it doing? It's first combining the nation table with itself, which is called a self-join in the database community, using nested loops. So remember earlier, we had to decide the sequence of tables, and we had to decide what is the algorithm implementing each of the operators in the sequence. So here the sequence is nation, customer, orders, line item, and then supplier. This is the sequence in which you're doing the join. What is the kind of algorithms you're using to implement the joins? Nested loops, hash join, nested loops, hash join again. This is plan P1. If you move to plan P3, now you see a different structure. Again, the same tables are there, the same joins are there, but now you look at the sequence. Supplier has come in here, line item, orders, and customer. Notice also the joins, only one nested loops, and then the rest are all hash joins. And this is actually also an example of a left deep tree, because on the right child of every operator here or every node, you find an actual table coming from the user, which is here. And then if you look at plan P5, which is the third plan that we saw. Now notice that again the sequence has changed. It's customer followed by orders, followed by line item. And in fact, the indices being used here, some of you would already have seen the B3 indices in your undergraduate course. Okay, so the B3 indices are coming into play here, supplier and so on. But notice now that there are many of the hash joins that you had before are now replaced by nested loops join. We'll not worry about what is the reason for all of this. You can explain the background for this. But basically what you see is that there are different strategies for different locations in the space. Okay? So this is very similar to what you do in cricket also, right? You say that you first have a plan A, saying that go and hit out in the first few overs. Then you immediately lose 5 wickets, right? Say, oh man, let me go and do plan B. Then you find that you lose 3 wickets very quickly. Then you say, go to plan C. Then what do? Plan D is to call the Shiv Sena in and dig up the pitch, right? That's the best thing you can do. So these are all different strategies at different locations in the space. Okay? Yeah. Okay, so that's a very good question. You could extend this in principle to n dimensions. For the purposes of visualization, I've just shown you with 2 dimensions. But in principle, you could extend it to higher dimensions as well, assuming that you had this kind of predicates, like in some other predicate you could have had, which is to say that the number of items in the line item table should be less than a certain constant C3 and so on. So you could do something like that. Okay? Yeah. Each dimension is essentially representing a predicate on a table, correct? A specific predicate on a table. It's not just a table, but a column on the table because you are doing a predicate on that. Right? Yes, you require an n-dimensional space, right? But I'll just hold that on the stack. I'll come back to it at the end of it. Why it usually will not be very large. Okay, it also depends on the fact as to whether some of these tables are very small. And then you have a few large tables. So just like in any other sphere of activity, you find that 10% of the people do 90% of the work, right? In fact, that's what our director also says. He keeps wanting to fire us, saying that I don't mind if I lose 90% of my faculty. I didn't miss them anyways. The other 10% are doing all the hard work. So here also you'll find that in any database system, 10% of the tables have 90% of the content. And then the others are there just for cosmetic value, for running around the trees and so on like that. So you have a few other things. Okay? But so you don't necessarily require it to be all n tables. Okay? But that's a good question. So we'll just stick to 2 dimensions for now. At the end of that talk, we'll come back to higher dimensions. Okay? So this is what you are seeing here. Okay. And then, as I told you, we also have what is called as the cost diagram, which is a complementary diagram to the plan diagram. So here, the cost diagram is a 3-dimensional diagram. The x and y axis are the same tables, or the same dimensions that you saw before, which is the total price of the orders and the account balance of the customer. So that's the xy plane. On the z axis now, you also are saying that I know red is optimal, but how expensive is red? Okay? That's the quantitative cost. So not surprisingly, if you come to this, which is the origin of this space, what is it physically telling you? It says that very little data is coming in because your constant C1 and C2 are low, which means few orders and few customers, right? Which means that the data processing is very simple, okay? Very few orders, very few customers. You can do it off the top of your head. So that is why the cost is low here. But as you go along this direction, it means you're pumping in more and more data. More and more orders are coming in, more and more customers are coming in, until you reach this top right corner where 100% of the customers in your database and 100% of the orders are all being combined together in some horrible fashion to produce the final result. Right? So the cost keeps increasing monotonically until you reach this value. And in fact, the numbers are also here. The minimum cost is roughly 6,000 units of time. And the maximum cost is 32,000 units of time. Okay, so this is the background to this tool called Picasso, which is essentially a Java-based tool, which most of you are familiar with, which given a multidimensional template. So I just showed you the 2-dimensional templates here, but given a multidimensional template and a choice of a specific database engine, so whether it's DB2 or SQL Server or Exadata or whatever you have, it will automatically generate for you all these plan and cost diagrams. It also has a lot of other nice features, but I won't go into that for now. So how does it generate these diagrams? What it does is that it produces a query with a particular value of C1 and C2. What is the value of C1 and C2? What corresponds to 10% here and 10% here is the first query that it'll create. And then it'll go to the database system and then say that, oh, great database system, given this query, what will you do? Okay. After some time, the database system will come back and it'll say that, I will choose the brown plan. Yes, you say, fine. Then what do? You construct the second query. What is the second query? 20% on orders and 10% customer. So you'll find new values of C1 and C2 such that it matches to this. Now what will you do? You'll again go back to the database system and say, oh great database system, what will you do here? It'll come back in a slightly annoyed tone of voice saying, didn't I tell you I'm going to use the brown plan again here? Right? It might do this again, And each time you have to remember to go and say, oh, great database system. Otherwise, it won't give you the answer. It'll give you a brown plan. But once you reach maybe 40% here, it says, now the brown plan is no longer the ideal choice. Now it's the blue plan here. So for example, in going from brown to blue, this may be a change in the sequence that you had of the joint relations, or it could be a change in the algorithm implementing the join operators. But there is some change. Okay? So by going through like this, you can essentially populate the entire space. Okay? So this picture has been drawn at a 10 by 10 resolution. So you have 100 different points. So you can go and basically use different colors for different plans. The colors by themselves don't mean anything. Okay. So it just means that this is a different plan from this one, which is different from here, which is different from here, and so on. And then what you can do is that to make sure that you have a complete picture, what you can assume is that in the neighborhood of any of these points, it's likely that the same plan will be used. Because just by adding one more row, it's not that it will suddenly change its whole view of life and say that now I'll move from Dvaita to Advaita or something like that, right? It will just say that I'll probably use the same plan around this here. So what we will do is to color this space with the same brown. And with this, now you get a complete, full continuous picture over the entire space. Okay. Now, before I just come to the pictures, what is the status of this tool? This is roughly around 60,000 lines of code. Okay, this is what the students promised me. Okay, I haven't explicitly checked myself. Every time I talk to them, they add a few thousand lines to make me feel that they've done some work. But it's with 100 different classes. It uses all these nice tools which some of you might already be familiar with. Java 3D, WSAD, JGraph, Swing, okay, all the graphics related stuff. It's operational on all the well-known culprits in the database industry, DB2, Oracle, SQL Server, Postgres, Sybase, and so on. Okay. So this is currently in use at many academic and industrial labs worldwide. So it's not just being used within IISc because we force the students to do it. It's actually being used at Carnegie Mellon, at Purdue, and Duke University in the US. But if you are a European fan, then it's technically University of Munich. Closer home, National University of Singapore, and also at IIT Bombay, although they won't admit to it very easily. Okay, like that. So also the companies like IBM, Microsoft, Oracle, all of them are also using this tool. Okay. And it also got the best software award about a few years ago in the VLDB conference, which is the top database conference in the world. This was held in Singapore in 2010. Okay. So now the question is that, why did the industry care about this tool? Okay. Because normally they consider the academics are the lower than life scum who are occupying the space in the conference halls. But the reason that it got some excitement within or traction within their community is that the tool allows you, as I'll show you in the rest of this talk, serious problems and anomalies in the way that currently database systems are designed. Okay? You thought you were, when you are paying this several crores, you got a wonderfully designed database system. Okay? Guess what? It's actually pretty crappy. The only reason that you did not realize this, you had no way of figuring it out. But with this tool, you can now open the can of worms and you'll find a large number of worms, including those from Jurassic Park and so on. Okay? So serious problems in current optimizer design. But from the database research perspective, you can use it as a testbed for trying out new ideas, and it's a great educational aid for students. So when they were doing your basic undergraduate course, they would have probably taken a couple of tables, maybe two or three at best, and said this is the way that you join and this is the best way to find out a query execution plan. But that's essentially a toying system because it's very hard to complete the whole thing in the space of a class or in a blackboard. But this tool actually allows you to see how industrial strength systems behave on industrial strength queries. Okay? So this is one of the special features of this work, is that this is being done essentially at the scale which industry is actually operating on. It is not an academic software or operating on academic size databases or queries, but this is being done actually at the same level at which industry is operating with real live installations worldwide. So in that sense, you might find it a fun tool to also play with. Okay? But then you might also be asking the question, why on earth in IISc you are sitting and doing all this pictorial software? We thought you guys were doing research. That's why I came here. Now you are doing all this stuff. So it's not software development for its own sake. Okay, we are not Infosys saying that somebody wanted a hotel reservation system. Fine, put 10 guys off the bench, put him here, take him through the training program in Mysore for 6 months, and then come and let him loose on this stuff. The reason that we are actually interested in this is that it has core underlying concepts of computer science built into it, including theory, algorithms, statistics, and tree matching. The tool only allows you to package this in an easily accessible manner, but it's not just that it's using a useful niche application, but it has interesting concepts which are built into the software. Okay. So let me just try to motivate that by showing you the rest of the the output that came from this tool. So what is the benchmark on which all this tool was operated on? As I said, this is the standard benchmark that comes from the industrial world. Okay. And for example, if you look at this TPCH database, it has, so here you have the names of the tables, which we already discussed, and here are the sizes of the tables. So coming back to what you asked, some of the tables are very small, so it really doesn't matter, okay? Whereas you look at the largest table, there are 6 million rows. So you find that you have this exponential curve even in the size of the tables. So you'll be worried about these tables, because if you make a mistake here, you're going to be in deep trouble. Here it really doesn't matter. Okay, so I won't go through the rest of it. Just assume that this is validated by industry and it's a reasonable setup. So now the question is that, why did we call this tool as Picasso? Okay. Because sitting in India, we should have called it either as MF Hussein, or you should have called it as Ravi Verma, right? We have two great artists from the country. We should have called it one of these two names, right? But instead, we have gone and called it as Picasso, okay? There's a technical reason why we called it Picasso. And that is because these plan diagrams are often similar to cubist paintings. Okay? Now, this raises the question is that how many of you are familiar with what are cubist paintings? It's not part of the Gates syllabus, but okay, very good. Yes, sir. Okay? And Pablo Picasso is one of the co-founders of this genre of painting, which was essentially conceived in the early 1900s in Paris. Okay? So this was a movement against the previous kinds of painting techniques, and I'll show you some examples of that in the rest of the talk. The rest of the talk is only pictures. Okay? We'll see this. Okay? So now, but I saw that many of you hadn't even heard of cubist paintings, let alone seen one. Right? So to put your mind at rest, here is an example of a very famous cubist painting. This was drawn by Georges Braque, who with Picasso was the co-founder of the school of cubist paintings. And as I said, all this happened in the early 1900s in Paris. And today it's a flourishing school of thought or school of art. Okay. What do you think this picture is about? Okay. What would you give as a title for this picture? Okay, so I'll put you out of your misery. This is actually supposed to be a woman with a guitar. Some of you are wondering which part is the woman, which part is the guitar, right? Okay, so here is part of the guitar. Okay, this is part of it. So now, the issue here is that prior to this, and I'll come back to why this is there, is that before the Cubist school of painting, some of you had a background in painting. What is the prior school called? Do you remember that? So that was the Impressionist school of painting. Yeah. The Impressionist school of painting used to say that take some real world scenery or view or object that you have and then come and represent it as faithfully as possible within your canvas. So for example, you have the Mona Lisa picture, there's a lady sitting there and then you are with an incongruous smile and then you're going to come and try to reproduce it as faithfully as possible within the painting that you've done. Okay. So, and in India, what would you get? You'd always get pictures like there'll be some boatman going down the river, there is coconut trees waving around there, there'll be some small village with a little bit of smoke coming out of the thatched roof. This boatman will be singing Kolaveri D or something like that, right? This is the typical picture that you would have here. So this is saying that there is some real world object or scenery or view that you have, and I would like to represent it as faithfully as possible within my painting. But what Picasso said is that this is very boring. Yeah. Who wants to do all this? Okay. So Picasso said that let's look at this woman's picture and then I will look at it with different facets, edges, angles, and in some sense perceptions. Yeah. So he took this picture and said that if I look at the woman from this side, what is the shape that I get? If I look at from here, what happens? Look from top, what happens? If I cut her head in the middle, what does happen? Okay. Then you get these different pieces. And what he did is make a collage of these pieces. So you can see this poor woman's head has been mutilated in many different ways and you have put all these together. Okay? So this is completely abstract art where you are saying that I'm looking at a certain object, looking at it from many different views and angles and perceptions and then putting this all together. Okay? Extremely expensive. Okay, although you may not like this painting, very, very expensive today as well. Okay? So, now you might say that, okay, fine, it's very interesting to see all of this, but where did you show me a cubist painting so far? Because the earlier picture that I showed you was those six different strategies, and they were non-linear, but they were nice hyperbolic curves. What's all the excitement about? Okay. So let me show you. So this is what I had shown you earlier. And there's nothing cubist about it at all, right? But this was done, as I said earlier, with the seventh query of the 22 queries in the benchmark, the seventh SQL query. If you move to the eighth query, okay, which is the one that you see here, query number eight. And again, all this is done with industrial strength systems. I cannot tell you the name of this because then they'll sue us and we don't have money to pay them, because the database companies are very rich and they have very good lawyers. So the moment you say something nasty about them, they'll come chasing you. And it's actually true. Okay? Whereas the other companies in the computer science industry will not come chasing after you because they cannot even pay the lawyers. Okay? Whereas the database industry is very different. So I'll just call it Optimizer A. Okay? And later on after the talk, if you want to come and find out what it is, you can meet me. But let's look at the picture that comes from this query number 8. This is the picture that you get. And again, just a two-dimensional space. Okay, in n dimensions, things are even worse. In just in this two-dimensional space here. Okay? Look at how many things have changed. Okay. After you recovered from the shock of seeing this picture, the number of different strategies here, because each color is a different strategy, okay, is 76 different strategies. And what you see here is that the largest plan, P1, which is this red colored plan, occupies roughly about 25% of the space. Okay? And as you come down, and this is in descending order, you find that the last plan, which is P76, occupies 0.01% of the space, which essentially means it's a pixel in this picture, and I'll defy you to find it here. Okay? So it's a single dot where the database query optimizer said use P76, not P75, not 73, not 72, 76 is right. Okay? So that's the first change that you see. Second change is that if you look at the contours of the boundaries of this optimality regions, earlier you had these nice straight lines or hyperbolic curves, but now it's completely irregular. It looks like the children's Lego blocks. That's what you are seeing here. Okay? And in fact, these pictures completely violate all the theory that had been there in database systems for a long time. For two decades, several people, especially those in India, including Sudarshan from IIT Bombay, whose textbook you might have seen, Sumit Ganguly at IIT Kanpur, had come up with all these nice theorems. And if you look at the database industry, they had forgotten to read those textbooks, it looks like, because by, in theory, all this should not have been possible, that you had this kind of a jagged contours and so on. But anyway, that's the real world. And then if you come down here, you find that you have, it's a complete jungle out here with this extremely intricate and complex patterns where there's a rapid change of the strategies that are being used by the database query optimizer. So now hopefully you will see the Picasso connection here, because if you stare at this picture long enough, you will see a woman with a guitar after some time here, okay? So at this point, you might say that if you are the industry side, what would you say? Say that, why are you complaining? You have so many different plans. Today, the name of the game is customization to specific customers. I'm personalizing the strategy for your specific query. Pay me more, right? That is the, but actually, that's not the case, because when you look at the cost diagram, which is this complementary diagram, which gives you the quantitative behavior on the qualitative surface, you find that all the plans are in this region here. And the within 20% of each other, with the numbers going from roughly 800,000 to around 1 million here. Okay? So what this actually tells you is that in today's industrial strength commercial systems, which you pay a very large amount for, because database systems are very expensive, tend to make extremely fine-grained and skewed choices, because you saw all those dots which are there. And the important point is that this is an overkill. This is not merited by the coarseness on the underlying space. So in some sense, rather than saying that you're doing too bad a job, you're trying to do too good a job. You are splitting hairs here, and unnecessarily so. Okay? So one of the interesting questions you can now ask here is that this is where the computer science theory part comes in, is can you take this original picture, which was complex with this large number of plans, and can you redraw the picture where you have some of these big plans eating the small plans without affecting the quality of the performance of the system? So you have the, some of the big guys, let's say, eating some of the smaller guys and still get, giving you reasonably good performance. So if you say that I will use Rahul Dravid to replace Virat Kohli, let's say, okay, this really doesn't make too much difference. Okay, Or actually a better example would be if you use Virendra Sehwag to replace Shikhar Dhawan, right? It makes no difference because both guys play without looking at the ball. Their rotation of the bat is an independent random variable to what is being happening, right? So they'll both anyway score zero. What does it matter if you put this guy will score one or zero, or worse, this fellow will run out the other fellow, right? So it doesn't really affect the overall quality. Now can you say that instead of having 11 players in the team, I only require 3 players? Harbhajan Singh, our best batsman, and then you require a couple of others to keep running with him and you're done, right? That is exactly what this is trying to do, okay? Yeah, but before I do that, I'll just give you a quick pass through this art gallery. Okay, I've already run out of time. Okay, so these are some of the other pictures that you can get from the Picasso tool. Okay? So here we call this as duplicates and islands. Why is this duplicates? Because you see the same dark purple plan also appearing in the center. Again, according to all the theory of two decades in the database academic community, this should all have been impossible. Okay, should not be possible to do this, but you actually have these duplicates here. And then you find this small island that you see here in this corner, which is the small pink plan, which is being surrounded by all this green stuff here. Okay? So those of you from West Bengal would probably know that until a few years back, we had this notion of what are called as exclaves, which are parts of India that are part of Bangladesh. Okay, this actually happened because two kings in the Kuch Bihar area used to play dice. Whenever they lost, they said, take that village for yourself. Somebody else, would, the other guy would win, says, take this village here. And they did not have spatial databases to check for geometric contiguity. So you actually had a situation where you would go from India into Bangladesh. Within that Bangladesh space, you would go into India again. Again, from India, you would go into Bangladesh and back into India. There's a 5-level depth that you could go through. So if you cross 2 kilometers, you would cross the international border 5 times. Okay? Because small pieces have been given away. And the kings were not bothered about whether they were contiguous or not. So recently, I think about a year ago, is when finally the Prime Minister of India and that of Bangladesh said that you take that land which is part of India, you take this here, and the exclaves were removed. Because otherwise, they were in some sense people with no identity because you could not give them any of the facilities from India because it's sitting in Bangladesh and vice versa and so on. Okay? So this is what you are having here. This is what is called as an exclave, a part of your country within somewhere else. Okay? Now, this is another picture. So, this is called the plan switch points. So, you see here that along this line, all the plans switch from, you go from left to right. And what is the change that is occurring? The sequence in which you join the tables, that is part supplier, joined with part, is now altered to a different sequence. So, remember, you said sequencing is very important. So, now instead it's part supplier followed by part and then supplier. The answer is the same. Running types are different. So when you cross the border here, you say that here I want to do it. So it's like saying that when I cross from India to Pakistan, the style of writing goes from left to right. It goes to right to left, right? Because Urdu is written right to left. So that is what happens along this border here. Okay. And one of my favorite pictures, this we call the Venetian blinds. Okay? So you can see that here there's a set of 6 different plans that are rapidly alternating. And what is happening is that a left deep hash join is replaced by a right deep structure. So a left deep structure like this is now replaced by a different structure of the plan. So, and then one of my favorites is called the footprint in the beach picture. You find that there is a plan here which has walked its way through this beach. Okay? On either side there is nice sand, but you have put your footsteps here. And what you see again is that this plan has a sort merge join, whereas the outside of it a hash join is being used. And the database system is saying that if you are sitting here and not on either side, I will use sort merge and not hash join. So, and then Christmas comes early in database systems. So you find the speckle pattern here where the green plan here is also sprinkled all over the space. Okay. Okay. So maybe I'll just slip this part since we have run out of time. So the basic issue was that over time, the database query optimizers have become very complex. These run into millions of lines of code, and it's not that we are just castigating them. It's a very hard problem also. Okay? So over 30 years, lots of different people have added stuff to this code. It's very hard to anticipate the interactions and side effects of the modules. So it's like acupuncture, right? You poke something in your foot, your head falls off, right? Same thing happens in database systems. When they taught you in the course, they said, oh, here is concurrency control, here is database recovery, here is query optimization. They're all independent parts. Don't believe it at all. Okay, terms and conditions apply. whatever change you make here has implications for the rest of it. We teach them as being independent modules, but there's lots of side effects. So, and notice that, okay, now you might say, how come you didn't realize this before? Why did it take 35 years of database technology for you to figure this out? The simple reason is that you go to the database system and what do you say? Oh, great database system, tell me the strategy. He'll come back with the strategy, right? Now, suppose you say, I don't think this is the greatest strategy. What will the database system tell you? It says, you go find one, right? And you can't go through the exponential search space itself. You have no basis for comparison. You know it's horrible. There's a gut feeling, but there's no way to prove it, right? So that's why this has, for a long time, been hidden under the covers. And it's not a deliberate hiding. Even the industry people are not aware of this. Because they used to look at individual queries and say, how do I fix this? They'll put a bandage here. But when you put the bandage here, your heart stops beating at the other end of the thing. Okay? So this is where the fact that you literally had to look at the big picture and realize that there's lots of side effects of what you're doing and try to come up with solutions to re-engineer this. Okay? So just before I wind up, I thought I'll just show you again the technical problems. So all this was interesting pictures, and if you find that you can't get a job after you're doing your BE because you came and did a PhD, somebody here was worried about that, use the Picasso tool. You can come up with good sweater designs. You can sell them in Majestic or any of the other places. Okay, very good tool for doing this. Okay. So you always have a backup plan. Okay. So can you take this plan diagram and recolor it with a smaller set of colors? Essentially, what you're saying is that some of the colors swallow the other colors. But you have to give this guarantee here. And this is where the constraint comes in. That because you're substituting an optimal strategy with a suboptimal strategy, is it the case that it becomes much worse, or can you bound it that you cannot become worse by more than some lambda percentage? Okay, so this is defined by the user, so you might say 10% margin. Earlier, if you're giving it to me in 10 seconds, at most you can take 11 seconds, but not beyond that. Okay? So this is the margin you give. And this is very similar if you want to think of it, is that suppose Sri Lanka gets fed up of fighting the LTT guys, which they've been doing for a long time. It says, just let's be annexed by India. It's much simpler. Then New Delhi has to deal with all these Tamil terrorist organizations in our state. Let's be annexed by India. But then you have to be assured that the cost of living of each Sri Lankan citizen is not increased by more than lambda percentage. And it's very important, the word each here, because we're not saying collectively, saying that the gross national product of Sri Lanka remains the same. We are saying every individual citizen should not have it increased by more than lambda percent. So we are interested in human rights, although we are database people. Okay. So you can show that this reduction problem, which is saying that taking a complex set of colors, creating a smaller set of colors subject to this constraint, where you replace, let's say, the red with a suboptimal blue, but you can only do the replacement if you can bound it within that lambda, that you can show is a computationally hard problem. And how do you do it? You can do it from a reduction from the set cover problem, which you'd already have seen in your complexity classes. You can also come up with algorithms. So if you see the papers on this, we have a greedy algorithm, which actually has a guaranteed approximation factor, which is logarithmic in M, where M is the number of query points that you have, which is the resolution of the space. So you might say this is not a very great approximation factor, but remember that Bhavna showed you a picture which showed Richard Karp on the left-hand side. Richard Karp is one of the fathers of complexity theory. So Richard Karp gave a talk here where he said that the greedy algorithms for set cover almost invariably perform as well as the optimal. You cannot prove it, but in practice you find that it closely approximates the optimal here. Okay? So you can show all these nice features that you can come up with a greedy algorithm which has this guaranteed approximation factors, and in reality it's often extremely good. So now, does it actually work? So I'll just stop with this thing. So you might say, okay, take this complex picture, make it simpler. What is the simpler constraint that you have? That whenever you replace, let's say, yellow with a red, the replacement should not make it worse by more than 10%. So if you had 100 before, at most you can go to 110. That's it. Okay? Otherwise, you're not allowed to eat. And remember, when you eat, you have to eat the whole thing. You can't say, I'll leave something on the plate, because then the color remains. So your goal is to minimize the colors. So if one color has to eat somebody else, it has to eat the entire color. So red cannot say, I'll just eat this part of the yellow and leave this for my friends. It has to eat the entire yellow, and only then it's there. So if I gave you this 10% requirement, yeah, how many plants do you think would result from the original 76? Obviously, it has to be less than 76. And obviously, you must have at least one plant. So you have a range from 1 to 76. Yeah. What would this the number that you'd expect, given that only a 10% margin is given to you? Choose your favorite number, right? Okay. Yeah, somebody said 57. Okay, I think I'll pretend I heard 57. Okay? Actually, it's not 57. Okay? If you do this with 10%, this is the picture that you get. 5. Just 5 plans. And what I'm telling you is that with just these 5 plans, I can give you whatever the previous picture gave you in all its wonderful complexity with at most a 10% deterioration in performance. That is what I said. But now you might say, okay, you chose this one particular query because it suited your objective. Maybe it doesn't work for other queries. Okay, but actually, we have shown that with a large number of templates of different kinds of queries coming from various benchmarks, this has been validated by the industry also. They have done all this testing. And what they have said is that if you give me a margin of 20%, any complex diagram, and many of the complex diagrams actually have many more plans than what I showed you. 76 is the tip of the iceberg. We have pictures with 800 plans. We have pictures with 500 plans and so on. What we can show you is that it will always come down to what we call as anorexic levels. And what we mean by that is that it will be an absolute number of 10 or less plans. So you can start with 700, you can start with 800, you can start with 1000. If you give me a margin of 20%, I will bring it down to less than 10. So why are we calling this anorexic? Anorexia in the medical terminology, if those of you are familiar with it, means that you are clinically ill in the sense that you are extremely thin. So it's not the size zero of Kareena Kapoor, not that kind of thinness. This is thinness because you are starving yourself. Okay? So you have two things, anorexia and bulimia, where one is where you become extremely fat, the other you become extremely thin. This is you are actually ill. You are liable to die because of this. Right? So anorexia means that you are actually reached a state where you are not eating anything and therefore have become painfully thin. So that is what we mean here, is that it's not a relative decrease, saying that I will give you something which is, let's say, 30% of the original number. So if it was 1,000 plants, then I'll give you 300. We are saying that no matter what you start with, any number of hundreds will always get you down to something which is clinically thin, which is 10 or less plants. Okay? And this has a lot of implications for the database industry, which is why they have been interested with this, because using this feature, now you can do a lot of re-engineering of the internals of the database system to make it operate much better. Okay? Yeah. So, as I said, this has played a meaningful role in many of the commercial systems today. If you want to see more about this, this is on our website. The entire set of papers, as well as the software, including source code, is completely free. You're welcome to download it. You're welcome to submit it as your BTEC project or BE project. Half of Madhya Pradesh has done that already. Okay? So you can go ahead and do this. Okay? But hopefully you might find it fun to play with. Sample diagrams coming from the software are also available on the website. And as I said, even if you don't like database systems, hopefully you like the pictures. Those of you with an artistic bent of mind will probably find this quite cute. This is computer-generated art. Okay? And yeah, so with that, I was told that you don't... I am supposed to ask the questions here. Right? So one of the questions here was that, okay, suppose I was the industry guy. I would come and look at this simplification of the picture and say, who cares? Okay? I had a complicated picture. You made it simpler. So what? It makes no difference to me. Why should I bother about it? Is it just a cosmetic exercise saying I did it because I could do it? Yeah? Or is there some reason that why this might be actually useful? Can you think of why it might be useful to replace that 76 complicated picture with just the 5 plans? Yeah. No, but the initially what you'll still have to do is to produce these 76 different choices, right? So you are only producing the 5 after looking at the 76. You don't know that in a priori, right? Yeah? You have less choices. Okay, why is that a good idea? I thought your generation says, I want more choice. Right? See, if you look at cars, okay, in my generation, you had exactly one car that you could choose from, which was the ambassador car, and you could either choose white or black, and this was it. Very simple life. Now you have so many different choices, right? So why is choice bad? No, here you have made the choices and then reduced them. So it's not that you have changed the search space. The search space remains the same, but what you have pulled out from it remains the thing. Okay, but let me ask you back, since you asked this question, why do you think less choice is good? Because it's... Right. Yeah, okay. So the basic reason is that if you have less choice, there's less chance of making a mistake. See, suppose you look at it from the education institutions. If your only choice was IISc, and let's say the Manipur Institute of Technology. Very simple for you. You didn't have to convince your parents you had to come here and so on. It was obvious to you, right? Now, given that there are many different good institutions, you have to start thinking about it. Yeah? Although in this case, you don't have to think about it. It's IISc and the rest, so it's simple. But less choice is good because there's less chance of making mistakes. Yeah? So, yeah, we'll give you the bag because he at least started on the right thing, saying that less choice is good. So here's actually all the other benefits of doing the reduction. It's not a cosmetic exercise. It has deep engineering implications because once you produce this thing, it gives you planned choices that are robust to errors in the process. So you remember I said 60% and 30%? Usually you get that wrong. You think it's 60 and 30, it turns out to be 5 and 16. The errors are also again large. So you thought you were in the red place and you find out you are in the yellow place here actually at runtime because this is all being done at the optimization time. So you get robust choices over much of the space because of the fact that you now have only one choice. So it's like saying that if you want to choose a cricketer for your pitch and you don't know whether the pitch, what kind of pitch it's going to be. It could be either a flat wicket or it could be a bouncy wicket. Who do you choose first? If you always knew it was flat, you would just take Sehwag. It doesn't matter, or Virat Kohli or whatever. But if you did not know in advance what kind of pitch it is, what is your safest bet? That's Rahul Dravid, right? This will give you the Rahul Dravid plans, which says that no matter what happens, I'll have guys who are fairly decent. Okay? In very specific cases, somebody else may be better. Okay? On that one pitch in Sehwag's home, maybe he'll score 300, fine. But in every other wicket in the world, Dravid is going to save your bacon. So that is what we are saying here, is that you get the Rahul Dravid plans will survive from here, and all the other ones which are neurotic in behavior will disappear from this picture. Yeah. So with that, I'll end my talk and sorry for extending it a little beyond what it was, but hopefully the pictures are worth it. Okay. And so any questions you might have? Okay. Thank you. Yes, sir. Thank you.
You would have all noticed that there are lots of nice examples.